There's really four lead characters in the movie. There's the characters Ryan and Emma play, there's the city, LA, and there's the music.
In this movie, it's a musical, so naturally the music is front and center.
You know, it's a musical, and so we live or die on the music.
If you're gonna have music in a movie, it should be not an afterthought. It should be taken as seriously as any sort of piece of writing in the script, because it's as powerful a storytelling tool. There's simply no other art form that is as emotionally direct, that just cuts through the muck right to your heart more than music.
Justin Hurwitz, who did the music on Whiplash, composed the music for this film, so it's this really beautiful score.
Justin and I met playing in a band together. I played drums and he played piano. He knew I wanted to do movies, he wanted to write film scores, and so we just kind of were simpatico on that front immediately, and our musical tastes were the same. He wrote the music for Whiplash, and he'll write the music for anything I ever do.
He's written every note of music in the film, the score, the songs, and much of the themes that you hear that are attributed to characters are all Justin's.
And we're so lucky to have his score because it's really special.
One thing that Justin and I talk about a lot that you don't really see in scores anymore is melody. Scores these days, in many cases, are very wary of the power that music has.
Music speaks to me as it speaks to many people in the world, such a deep way, because music has no filter. It creeps into our souls.
There's something about truly great melodies, not just beds of sound, but great melodies and great orchestrations lifting what's on screen. To me and to Justin, that kind of thing was the ideal. It was the thing we always talked about. It was the thing we bonded over when we were college roommates. And it was kind of the pinnacle we were chasing as we were working on music together.
The goal, compositionally and orchestrationally, for me was always to make something that would be timeless in that it wouldn't sound like 2016, but it also wouldn't sound like I was trying to be 1955 either.
Justin was writing music as I was writing the script. They were informing each other.
One of the big goals for me and Damien, going back to the beginning, was that we were creating something that didn't feel like it was trying to be old-fashioned, that didn't feel like a museum piece.
And that's what we did for about 5 years, was just sort of developing the music and the movie simultaneously.
From the earliest days of the script, Damien had sort of treatments for the songs in the script. You know, there's gonna be a song here on the freeway that does this dramatically or accomplishes this narratively.
We just had this dialogue, and it's a dialogue that's continuing even today, and it's just the most fun, fulfilling, creative dialogue I've ever had with anyone.
I love it.
Basically, my process with Damien is I work at the piano. It's always at the piano because we like to hear things kind of in their most stripped down form to sort of assess whether a melody can stand on its own or can really stick with you. If a melody or if music can work in its sort of barest form, if it's memorable, if it's beautiful, if it moves you sort of without all the bells and whistles of orchestration or even lyrics, then it's a melody worth keeping.
One of the great joys of this film was composing the music alongside the development of the script and the other elements.
The first music I composed for the movie was actually the theme of the movie. It was called Me and Sebastian's Theme. It's what Ryan's character Sebastian is playing in the restaurant. It had to be a love theme, it had to be romantic, but it also had to have some real melancholy in it because it's not the happiest of love stories in the end. So there had to be some, you know, bittersweet tones in it.
He would send us hundreds of piano demos, and it was just incredible to see these things come to life.
I remember around demo 16 or so, we had one that we really liked. Well, by the time I got to 31, basically, it was the theme, but it was structurally a little different. The theme structurally doesn't change that much, aside from sort of deviating into free jazz when Sebastian plays it at the piano.
I just heard you play, and I want to...
I practiced some of those piano pieces 4 hours a day for 3 months. I mean, I should technically never want to hear them again. But every time I hear them, I'm still moved by them.
Tim, we want to make sure we're really pushing the horns in 407.
Justin literally lives and breathes music and is allergic to compromise. I mean, he's incredibly collaborative, but he won't sacrifice quality for anything.
You tell Justin something, he will go home and do it 8,000 times until he gets it perfect.
As I was composing melodies, I was thinking a lot about, are these melodies that can work in a score, that can work dramatically, making sure that everything was of a piece, making sure that all the songs would feel like they belong to the same body of work, to the same musical, melodically, orchestrationally, emotionally.
I should probably tell you something now, just to get it out of the way. Mm-hmm. I hate jazz. Are you okay?
Tonight we're on a mission. Tonight's the casting call.
Because of the nature of how the project had been set up, you know, Justin and I had been working on it for years and years. And so these songs had become sort of very kind of codified, and these melodies had really sort of taken shape.
Someone in the crowd would be the one you need to know.
So we needed incredibly nimble, adept, sort of acrobatic, lyrical workers who could burrow into what Justin had done and make it feel like it was always intended to be that way.
They were writing to melodies that were by and large fixed in advance, which is enormously challenging.
That, of course, the music was set to these words.
You know, we interviewed 5 or 6 people.
But we basically auditioned people with a song and sent them City of Stars, just musically. And we got some really great ideas.
Passing and Paul were the clear winners.
Passing and Paul sent us their first version, and that's essentially what's in the film.
About a year ago in, I guess, August of 2014, when we heard about the guys, yeah, and heard about the film, and we got involved.
Bench Passing and Justin Paul themselves are composers as well. They come from the sort of hallowed Stephen Sondheim Broadway tradition of words and music, and they're responsible for both usually. So they understood both sides of the equation, and they were able to really just become this incredible component of our collaborative team.
Bench and Justin are terrific songwriters in their own rights. They're a new contemporary voice to be reckoned with.
It's an interesting challenge to come onto something where there's sort of already pre-existing music that's been written, and our job is to come on and lyricize basically those melodies in the music.
City of stars, are you shining just for me?
It's really actually impressive what they were able to do working within the confines of music that already existed.
We usually write music and lyrics together, and we are able to talk about, you know, what is the song gonna say, or what would be a potential title, and then we go from there. But what was so challenging and ultimately really exciting about this was it was like the hardest Sudoku or hardest crossword puzzle that we've ever had to do, because the music is pre-existing.
Is this the start of something wonderful?
It's kind of amazing that they managed to come up with so much poetry under those circumstances.
You know, it made us think outside of normal patterns that we would usually think in.
Musically, you go City of Stars, that thing that everybody wants.
It's not about what's the most clever lyric or the smartest lyric or the funniest lyric. It's about what lyric is narratively correct and expresses the character's voice.
They are telling story, they are illuminating character, and doing that within the parameters of these melodies and these songs that musically already existed.
He's created something with the music that is timeless and that I think keeps you on your feet.
There wasn't room really to vary the melody to accommodate lyric. And the story of each song is also very specifically dictated by Damien as the writer of the piece.
Damien is also a wonderful collaborator because he really knows what moments do jump out as being song worthy. You know, he really identified, I think, moments, yeah, that where the emotion is really, really high, where characters would naturally break into song and that would be worthy of singing.
Where in another movie you might have a monologue or just a little story becomes this kind of big musical number.
Say there's nothing here, well, let's make something clear. I think I'll be the one to make that call.
You'll call.
We had new drafts of the songs frequently, so I would arrange the vocals and then go into Marius's home studio to demo them.
And maybe this appeals to someone not in heels.
I
and we would go to Marius, who was our music supervisor's house, where he has a studio, and we would record, and it was just, you know, all these kind of new experiences that were really fun.
All I can say about Justin Horowitz's songs is that I can't imagine listening to music this much and not being sick of it in any other context. But this, for some reason, it's still beautiful every time I hear it.
What a waste of a lovely night.
I knew from the beginning that in addition to writing the music part of the songs, that I would be scoring it, orchestrating it, which is not always the case in musicals. A number of the score cues are sort of derived from the song melodies that I had written at an earlier stage. My challenge was figuring out how to use some of the melodies from the songs, figuring out how to use that material dramatically throughout the movie under a lot of different kinds of scenes. And I loved, you know, whether I was taking a melody from a song and making it playful, or melancholy, just finding those colors using the orchestra.
Super good on the timing at the end. We need to attack it more at the front.
It's amazing to be here scoring La La Land on the same stage where they scored Singing in the Rain and all those great MGM musicals.
It's a magnificent room. It's a room which just has so much character and personality. It sings beautifully without ever becoming muddy.
I've never been on a scoring stage this size. I've never been with an orchestra this size. And Justin and I had always kind of imagined that this would be like a 90-piece orchestra putting his music to the screen on this, so it's amazing.
The scoring session was, I think, 4 days of orchestra. The orchestra was 95-piece at its biggest.
I just know that Justin and I always wanted this to be recorded the old-fashioned way, with a big orchestra all together in one room.
The music couldn't have been given a better place to take place and a better context in which to be recorded.
It's one thing to imagine it, it's another thing to actually be here doing it. It's amazing.
Hearing the orchestra for the first time play my orchestrations when they'd been in MIDI for so long is always, it's the most thrilling point of the whole process, I think.
As soon as I stepped in the first day and they were doing some of the big, most complicated charts in the movie, it just took a lift in such a way that I was embarrassed that I'd even liked the MIDI to begin with.
And even when the answers no are, when my money is running low, dusty mic and neon glow are all I need.
It is a musical voice that, like Damien, draws upon history and films gone by and music gone by, but comes out in its own grammar, in its own language.
It's a musical. It's very much in the style of like old MGM 50s, 60s musicals, a lot of which they recorded on this stage, so I'm very happy to be here.
It's just, you know, humbling to be in this space where there's so much history.
I didn't even realize until a few days before scoring that we were gonna be on this stage where they did like Somewhere Over the Rainbow, like a stage with this kind of history. I can't really put into words. It's incredible.
Amazing, because that's, of course, where, you know, Singing in the Rain and The Bandwagon and all those musicals we love, so many of them were recorded.
These were the scores we were studying, and these were the recording sessions we were studying.
You always think that spaces that you record in, whether it's Bearsville or the Streisand stage, are haunted or informed or sort of somehow inhabited by the history of the music that's been made there. And it's one of those places that just has a vibrancy to it that I'm sure is to do with that those walls have seen.
There's some giants in terms of the ghosts kind of hovering here. It was kind of the feeling I got also during a lot of the shoot, whether on the Warner Brothers lot or shooting in the city of LA, but shooting parts of LA, you know, Griffith or whatnot, where some of those iconic movie moments that we've all grown up with happened. You know, there's something about LA, there's a magic to it, there's that sense of ghosts everywhere in LA that I find really bewitching and enchanting and, you know, perfect for a musical.